right, good morning. Good to see each and every one of you. Stand with me, if you will. Page 262 in the song books. Holy, holy, holy. We're going to do all four verses of page 262.
Amen. All right, you can be seated this morning, and we do welcome you and greet you to our morning worship service here at Parkwood Baptist Church. Let me just make a few announcements, and we'll move forward into our song service. Remember choir practice at 5 o'clock on Sunday evenings. Of course, you see we've got the choir behind us, but there's plenty of empty seats here, and so we want you to join us and join the choir at 5 o'clock on Sunday afternoons. Got a couple specials in the works, and so come get in on that. We would sure appreciate that. And then also at 5, the children's choir is practicing as well in room 105 right across the hall there. And so if you've got children, then have them here at 5 o'clock if you can. They're going to begin practicing every Sunday evening, and I believe that starts tonight, I believe. Is that right? So first practice is at 5 o'clock this evening, and so keep that in mind. Ladies, your first Bible study for your monthly study is starting back up. The first one is on September the 19th. That's a Tuesday, September the 19th. A book entitled What Matters Most, a study in the book of Philippians. It says, join us for the first of 7 Bible study sessions, discovering contentment and joy in the midst of it all by prioritizing what matters most, Christ. That'll take place right here in the fellowship room at 6:30 on September the 19th. There is a sign-up sheet for that, and so if you plan to be here, ladies, make sure you sign your name for that. Sign up for that. All right. Don't know of any other announcements. We do have some birthdays I need to make mention of. One, we're going to go back a little bit, just because she wasn't here. Miss Carolyn had a birthday. Where is Carolyn? Very back. Okay. Carolyn had a birthday on the 20th, and she's She's got a job now, and they required her to work a couple Sundays, and so she wasn't able to be here. But Carolyn had a birthday on the 20th, so we want to acknowledge that. Happy birthday. Happy late birthday. And then Miss Carol Smith has a birthday on the 12th this week, so happy birthday to Miss Carol. And then Brian and Monica Smith have an anniversary today. All right. Brian, did you know that? Okay. All right. All right. Good. Good. Brian and Monica Smith have an anniversary today, so happy anniversary to them. Any other birthdays or anniversaries I can mention? We want to include you in this group and get sung to this morning. All right. Yes, ma'am. All right. Happy anniversary. Happy anniversary, both of you, Brother Richard, Miss Lou Ann. Then my mom was here. She had a birthday on September the 5th, so it's going back last week, but good to have my parents here today. Happy birthday to my mama as well. All right, well, let's sing happy birthday and happy anniversary to these, Brother Ken.
Before we do, hold on just a second. Before we do, I have an announcement that we knew he wasn't going to make. There is a baby shower going on for Baby Ellis. They're set out right outside the nursery there. There's a basket there, so you'll see that. So bring some gift cards and things like that. Everybody knows about that. And like the note says, we knew he wasn't going to announce it, so that way we got that taken care of. So now let's do birthdays, all right? Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. God bless you. Happy birthday to you. Other than the happy anniversaries. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary to you. Happy anniversary. God bless you. Happy anniversary to you. All right, stand with me again. Page number 270, Wonderful Words of Life. We'll do all three verses of page 270, Wonderful Words of Life.
Sing them over again to me, O wonderful words of life. Let me more of their beauty see, O wonderful words of life. Words of life and beauty teach me faith and duty. A beautiful words, a wonderful words. Wonderful words of life, a beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Christ the Blessed One gives to all wonderful words of life. Sinner, list to the loving call, wonderful words of life. All so freely given, wooing us to heaven. A beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. A beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Sweetly echo the gospel call. Wonderful words of life. Offer pardon and peace to all. Wonderful words of life. Jesus, only Savior, sanctify forever. A beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life. Beautiful words, wonderful words, wonderful words of life.
One more, page 275. We'll do all four verses. Last verse, ushers, you can come on the last verse. Page 275, How Firm a Foundation.
How firm a foundation, ye saints of the Lord, is laid for your faith in his excellent word. What more can he say than to you he has blessed to you, who for refuge to Jesus has fled. Fear not, I am with thee. Oh, be not dismayed, for I am thy God, and will still give thee aid. I'll strengthen thee, help thee, and cause thee to stand. Thy help by my righteous omnipotent hand. When through fiery trials the pathway shall lie, my grace all sufficient shall be thy supply. The flame shall not hurt thee, I only desire thy dross to consume and thy gold to refine. The soul that on Jesus had leaned for repose, I will not desert to its foes. That soul all hell should endeavor to shake, I'll never, no, never, no, never forsake.
All right, ushers, y'all come on at this time, and we will take our morning tithes and offerings. And so I trust that you'll give as God has prospered you according to his word this morning. And Miss Char let me know that the offertory hymn she's about to play is in our hymn book. It's song 389, a wonderful hymn called More About Jesus. If you'd like to follow along with her, those words, she'll be playing that. I'm sure you know the song by heart, but you'll be able to pick up on it pretty easily. Amen. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and ask him to bless our offering, bless our worship service this morning. Lee, you want to pray for us, buddy? All right, pray for us, Lee.
Brother Ricky's got our special this morning.
deep within the heart has always known that there is freedom somehow breathed into the very soul of life. The prisoner, the powerless, the slave have always known it. There's something that keeps reaching for the sky. And even life begins because a baby fights for freedom. And songs we love to sing have freedom's theme. Some have walked through fire and flood to find a place of freedom, and some faced hell itself for freedom's dream. Let freedom ring wherever minds know what it means to be in chains. Let freedom ring wherever hearts know pain. Let freedom echo through the lonely streets where prisons have no key. We can be free and we can sing. Let freedom ring. God built freedom into every fiber of creation, and he meant for us to all be free and whole. Oh, but when, my Lord, but freedom through the blood of his redemption, his cross stamped pardon on my very soul, and I'll sing it out with every breath. I'll let the whole world hear it. This where prisons have no key, we can be free, and you can sing life. streets where prisons have no key. You can be free and you can sing, let freedom ring. You can be free and you can sing.
Thank you, Ricky. Of course, the Bible says, if the Son shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. And ultimate freedom is found in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you, Ricky. I invite you to take your Bibles and turn to John chapter 16, John's Gospel, the 16th chapter, and we will continue our exposition through the Gospel of John on Sunday mornings. We have made our way to the end of the 16th chapter. It's taken us 63 or 64 messages to get here, but we're here nonetheless. And I remind you that John wrote this gospel to convince us, the readers, his audience, of course that includes you and I, that Jesus is who he said he was, that he did what he said he did, and that he will do the things that he said he would do. Of course, John said in John chapter 20, verse 31, I wrote these things. These have been written so that you may believe that Christ is the Son of God. And John says, if you'll believe that, you can have eternal life in his name. And so we find ourselves in John chapter 16. We'll begin our reading in verse 25 this morning. John chapter 16, verse 25. The Bible says, these things have I spoken unto you in Proverbs. The time cometh when I shall no more speak unto you in proverbs, but I shall show you plainly of the Father. At that day you shall ask in my name, and I say not unto you that I will pray the Father for you. For the Father himself loves you, because you have loved me and have believed that I came out from God. I came forth from the Father and am come into the world. Again, I leave the world and go to the Father. His disciples said unto him, Lo, now speakest thou plainly, and speaks no proverb. Now are we sure that we know all things, and needest not that any man should ask thee. By this we believe that thou camest forth from God. And Jesus answered them, Do you now believe? It's almost like Jesus says, can I translate that for you before we move forward? Really? You sure about that? Notice verse 32. Behold, the hour cometh, yea, is now come. You shall be scattered, every man to his own, and shall leave me alone, and yet I'm not alone, because the Father's with me. These things I've spoken unto you, that in me you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world. Turning Point magazine recorded the pretty interesting story of a day in the life of Mrs. Ruth Jones. Of course, that name probably rings no bells to any of us, but the year was 1944, and Mrs. Jones was a pastor's wife in Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. And every day she was greeted by a casualty list from World War II and the stories of the slow, painful progress by the Allied forces. And so with war abroad, with rationing at home, this pastor's wife, mother of five children, was under a lot of stress and a lot of strain. One particular morning, she happened to be doing her morning devotion, and she opened to 2 Timothy chapter number 3, and she began to read in verse number 1, where the Bible says that in the last days there will be perilous times. And she began to think about that, and a tune emerged in her mind, and lyrics began to flood her mouth. And the melody and the lyrics were soon wedded together in what would become one of the more popular hymns of the 1940s and the 1950s. It's words like, the words go like this. In times like these, you need a Savior. In times like these, you need an anchor. Be very sure your anchor holds and grips the solid rock. Now, it's doubtful that any of us this morning are worried about an encroaching army in a foreign war. But your marriage might be killing you. You probably aren't worried about facing a Nazi attack this morning, but you may be in hand-to-hand spiritual combat on the job. You're probably not going to read a casualty list in the newspaper in the morning, but the doctor's report that you're going to receive this week might be just as fearful to you. In any of these cases, these words of Christ can help you and I in times like that. At the close of John chapter number 16, we're only about an hour or so away from the arrest of Christ in Gethsemane. And yet, the Lord Jesus Christ pauses and he closes this upper room discourse, this farewell sermon, if you will, with words of peace and love and comfort. The Holy Spirit would later bring these words to the minds of these apostles to help navigate the challenges of first century persecution. And yet, by divine inspiration, the apostles ultimately put these words in the hands of you and I this morning. And my prayer today is that the Holy Spirit would help us get the words off the page and into our hearts so that when you and I face difficult times in life, we too can experience this peace and comfort. Our title, if you want one this morning, is Facing Difficult Times. In those difficult times, three things I'll bring to your attention from the text. Number one, Jesus brings clarity. He brings clarity in our times of confusion. Jesus is saying that up to this point, if you'll notice back in verse 25, he says, up to this point, I have been speaking to you in proverbs, literally figurative language. But the time is coming and perhaps is now here that I'm about to speak to you very clearly. Up to this point, his words and his messages have been somewhat veiled, if you will. He's used a lot of parables. He's used a lot of comparisons, a lot of analogies. He's called himself a vine, bread, light. He told them, if you recall from last week, that you can turn sorrow into joy and sadness into gladness. And he compared that to the birth of a child in the life of a woman. Now he says, the way that I'm going to be speaking to you is about to change. I'm not going to sugarcoat things. I'm not going to beat around the bush. I'm going to be very clear and very, very plain. I love this story of the old couple who had been married 60 years. And the old man told his wife of 60 years, he said, "For 60 years, baby, you have been tried and true." And the woman yelled, "Huh?" So he spoke up a little louder. He said, "For 60 years, sweetheart, you have been tried and true." The woman yelled, "Speak up. You know that's my bad ear." And he said, "For 60 years, you've been tried and true." And she finally yelled, "Well, that makes two of us. I'm about sick and tired of you too." It's bad enough when you can't see clearly with your eyes or hear clearly with your ears. But how many of us are guilty of not being able to clearly sense God in our spirit? That word proverbs, figure of speech. Leon Morris, who's a very well-respected scholar in the Gospel of John, says it means a dark saying, one that requires hard thinking to get through the truths being expressed. Now, I have discovered in my life, and I've witnessed in the lives of others as a pastor, that sometimes you and I don't hear God communicate very clearly. Many times we don't see him moving with clarity. And a lot of times it's our own fault. It's because we aren't willing to dig down and roll up our sleeves and do the hard work that is required of being a disciple of Jesus Christ. Who can blame the apostles at this point in time? They really don't understand all of this talk about death and resurrection. It's new to them. Jesus is about to help them understand pretty clearly here. Notice he's going to do it in a few ways. Number one, he's going to talk about divine revelation from God. He says in verse 25, if you'll go back to the text, "These things have I spoken unto you in proverbs, But the time cometh when I shall no more speak unto you in proverbs, but I shall show you plainly the Father. And so we know this speaks, and I don't have time to really dig into this verse alone. But we know, in essence, what this speaks of is the coming, number one, of the Holy Spirit, and number two, the coming of the completed Word of God, what you hold in your hand this morning. The Spirit would come at Pentecost, and of course, the Word of God, the Scriptures, would be given over the course of time. We can think back in times of Old Testament. God spoke in numerous ways. He spoke through burning bushes, and one time a talking donkey, angelic messengers, and others. But those instances, as Dr. James Montgomery Boyce calls, they're unusual means of communication from the Lord. Let me ask you this morning, are you looking for a word from God? You've got one if you have a Bible. You ever wished that you could just hear the audible voice of God speak to you? Read your Bible out loud. You'll hear Him loud and clear. Friend, the primary way of knowing God's will is by studying what you have in your lap or on your smartphone today and allowing the Holy Spirit of God to take these truths and make them come alive in your life. Let me just say, and practically speaking, that's why you ought to be here on Sundays. I know I'm speaking to the crowd here. That's why you ought to be here in Sunday school and Wednesday night for Bible study. I cannot tell you how many times, happened recently, where someone come to me and asked for my advice or my guidance or my counsel on a certain subject. It just so happened I had preached on that within the prior week. Let me repeat something that I said earlier in this chapter a few weeks ago. I'm talking about divine revelation from God. When we talk about that, understand that God is not going to tell you one thing that you will not find in the Word of God. I told you recently, I was watching the show First 48, and they were looking for a murder had taken place. I think it happened here in Houston. And they were looking for the killer, and the deceased had a voicemail on his cell phone, a threatening voicemail, and they were wondering if their prime suspect, if that was his voice on that voicemail. And so they recorded him speaking, and they took what was a known recording of their prime suspect and compared that to the one in question to see if that was him or not. In the same way, when you hear a voice or you get an impression or you think God is leading you in one direction or sense that God may be speaking, take that suspicious message and compare it with the known message, because they will not contradict if it is of God. John MacArthur said the Holy Spirit's leading will always be consistent with God's revealed will in the Bible. He will never lead anyone to violate the principles of the Word of God. In other words, the Holy Spirit is not bipolar, and He's not schizophrenic. He's not going to say one thing in the Word and something else in private conversation. The Spirit of God is not like a politician who will say one thing publicly and a totally different thing privately. He's not going to tell the whole church in His Word to do something and then tell you or me to do something different. He's not going to tell the whole world to not be unequally yoked and then send you out on an evangelistic date. He doesn't do that. He's not going to tell the whole world to forsake not the assembling of ourselves together and then tell you He'll meet you on the bass boat during Sunday school next week. He's talking about divine revelation from God. But then notice in verse 26, there's direct relationship with God. He says, "At that day you shall ask in My name, and I say not unto you that I will pray the Father for you." Notice verse 27. "For the Father Himself loveth you because you've loved Me and have believed that I came out from God." Now, let's break that down. Here's what Jesus is saying. He says, when this day comes, the one I've been leading up to that we've been talking about, when I'm leaving you and you can't come with Me, He says, when that comes, you are going to have direct access to the Father Himself. Now, pay attention to what I'm about to say. I want to drill down just for a moment. Get a little pastoral here, because there are some religious systems that teach you that you need a human mediator if you're going to have access to God. For example, they'll tell you that you've got to go through an earthly priest If you have any hope of getting in touch with God. Friend, if you understand the Bible, you know that you don't need an earthly priest. Because you have an eternal priest who forever lives at the right hand of God the Father to make intercession for you. And he is the Lord Jesus Christ. I'm glad that through the death, burial, and resurrection that I don't need an earthly priest. I have an eternal priest that I don't need to go through some supposed father on earth. I can go directly to my Father in heaven. I don't need intercessory help from a dead saint when I've got a living Lord who intercedes for me. In the confusing seasons of life, I can get clarity from one source, and it is the Lord Jesus Christ. The New Testament makes it very clear that Christ is interceding for us. According to 1 Timothy 2:5, he is our mediator. According to Hebrews 7:25, he is our intercessor. According to Romans 5:10, he has reconciled us to the Father. The great hymn writer Fanny Crosby put it this way, "O come to the Father through Jesus the Son." Christ is preparing his disciples for life without him, as we have seen for probably 2 months at this point. And here he's preparing them for the reality that his death is going to allow them direct access to the Father. Of course, we see that very plainly. When he died, when he breathed his last, the veil of the temple was ripped from top to bottom. One of my favorite verses in the Bible, one man called it God's phone number. Jeremiah 33:3, the Bible says, "Call unto me, and I will answer you, and I will show you great and mighty things that you do not know." Sometimes in my study, if I'm doing schoolwork or preparing a sermon or whatever, and I come across a passage of Scripture that is just tough, it's confusing, it's hard to interpret. Boy, sometimes the thought comes to my mind, boy, it would be wonderful if I could pick up the phone and call a Chuck Swindoll. Or a Warren Wiersbe, or an Adrian Rogers. There have been a couple times when I picked up the phone and I called my friend Paige Patterson and I said, "Doc, I need some help on this passage." Friend, when I'm struggling with life, though, I don't have to call an earthly man. I can call on my Heavenly Father. I have direct access to him. I wonder, are you facing a crossroads in life and you don't know if you need to go left or right or straight or back? You don't know what to do. Jesus said, in those times of confusion, I will bring clarity. When I'm in doubt, when I'm confused, Christ said, look to him. Look to him. Jesus brings clarity in times of confusion. Then secondly, notice in verses 27 through 32, Jesus brings faith in times of failure. In just a few moments from these very events, Simon Peter is going to give one of the most infamous denials of Christ. As a matter of fact, for 2,000 years, the denial of Jesus by Simon Peter has received a whole lot of attention from us, and rightly so, because it was Simon Peter who boldly said, you know, declared his commitment to Christ, "I'll never deny you, Lord, not me." But he did. But Simon's not the only one that failed the Lord on this very night. Of course, by sunrise, Judas will have delivered him, Peter will have denied him, and every apostle apart from John will have deserted him. It's a fulfillment of prophecy in Zechariah chapter 13, verse 7. "For this night is over, the temple guards will arrest Jesus." And Zechariah 13, 7 says that the shepherd will be smitten and the sheep will all scatter. Of course, that took place right here. But let's not be too hard on these men. I'll speak for myself this morning. I know all too well what it means to sing prone to wonder. Lord, I feel it. When my flesh comes calling, oh, there have been times I've deserted him. What about you? When pride and my agenda came, when it came for you, I'm sure we've all forsaken Christ. I have no problem being honest in telling you that there's been times when the choice came between pleasing Christ and pleasing Wesley. Unfortunately, all too often I have chosen the pathway of disobedience. But aren't you glad that even in those moments of failure, while you may not have been faithful and while I may not have been faithful, God always was? And he's that way for a few reasons. Number one, because of his passion. Notice in verse 27, it says, "For the Father himself loveth you because you've loved me." Now don't misunderstand this verse. You've got to read this in context. This does not mean that the Father loves us because we love Jesus in the sense that his love is a reaction to our love. That would contradict Scripture. 1 John 4:10 says, "And this is love, not that we loved God." 1 John 4:19 says, "We love him because he first loved us." We sing it all the time. Oh, how I love Jesus because he first loved me. Augustine said this, "God would not have wrought in us something that he could love were it not that he loved us before he wrought it." Here's what this verse means. When you feel like a failure and you blow it and you mess up royally, keep in mind God did not look down through time and think, "Boy, there's somebody there. He's got it together. She's got it together. And if I could just get them to accept me as their Savior, boy, I could use them." That never took place. God's not surprised that you and I are such mess ups. He knew it before the foundation of the world. You and I are wretched sinners apart from Christ. Someone says, "Well, I feel like such a wretch when you preach." Good, that means you're listening. But it doesn't mean you're listening to the whole sermon. Because while you and I are wretches, Christ is wonderful. God is not a talent scout looking for a hot new five-star recruit for his team. I don't want to hurt your feelings this morning, but let's be honest, you and I really don't bring a whole lot to the table. Who does God use? Weak, fallen, fragile, and broken. If you feel like a wretch, that moves you to the top of the list for God to use. Failure is not final, and it's because of the great love of your great God, the passion of the Father. Notice this, though. In times of failure, he brings faith, and that is secondly because it's in spite of the presumption of his followers. Now, I want you to pay attention here. There's some spiritual arrogance in the text that's going to show its ugly head. You'll miss it if you don't pay close attention. Casual reading of the text, you won't see this. But notice in verse 29, his disciples said unto him, "Lo," like a light bulb came on. "Now speakest thou plainly, and now speakest," no proverb. You're not speaking in figurative language anymore. "Now we're sure thou knowest all things. Needest not that any man should ask thee." And notice this, "By this we believe." In verse 31, Jesus said, "Really? You sure, fellas? You really believe now?" You see, after a brief discussion of the gospel in verses 27, verse 28, now all of a sudden the disciples feel like they're ready to graduate from the school of discipleship. You say, "Well, they've been with the Lord for 3.5 years. Maybe they are." Well, go back 12 verses. Verse 18, I think it is, they said something like this, "We have no clue what he's saying. Went right over our head. We don't get it, Lord. Any of y'all have any idea what he's saying?" "I don't know what he's saying." 12 short verses later, verse 30, "Now we've got it figured out. Now we're experts. We know it all." Warren Wiersbe said, "It's not what ignorant people don't know that hurts them. It's all the stuff they think they know that isn't so that hurts them." It's not that they believe something wrong. Oh, they really did believe in Jesus, no doubt about it. But they didn't believe everything about Jesus that Jesus needed them to learn. If they were living in 2023, they would be like the person who says, "I know I'm saved. No need for me to go to church. I know those Bible stories. I know all about Noah and his ark and David and killing the giant and Jonah getting swallowed by the whale. I know all those Bible stories. I don't have to go to Sunday school. They're not going to teach me anything. I know all about spiritual warfare. No need for me to pray. Have you seen my family? My family is in tip-top shape. You're not going to tell me anything." These disciples would have yawned through the sermon, slipped out during the invitation, skipped the evening service, and fallen flat on their face spiritually and asked themselves, "How did that happen?" They thought they had it figured out. They thought they were further down the road than they really were, and the events of this night are going to reveal that their faith is not as strong as they thought it was. One writer said this, "Their bold notion was premature, and their faith, though genuine, was immature." Friend, the problem with immature faith and premature faith is that it's never going to be mature faith unless you address it. You see, moments before their colossal failure, where all of them are going to desert the Lord, they're telling Jesus, "We got it all figured out. We're experts. Makes sense now, Lord. You don't have to say anything else. We know what you're talking about." How about you? Has a thought ever come to your mind, God can't use me because I've blown it? Or on the other side of the coin, does a thought ever come to your mind, I can't blow it because of how God is using me? And yet in both cases, you're wrong. And in both cases, we have Jesus for a time like that. He brings clarity in times of confusion. He brings faith in times of my failure. Lastly, he brings strength in times of my struggle. I see that in verse 33. It's one of the most troubling and yet tremendous promises you'll find in all of the Bible. It is in direct contradiction to the prosperity preachers of our day. Jesus raises his voice and he lowers the boom and he says, "In this world you shall have tribulation." Job said in Job 14:1 that man that's born of woman, and by the way, that's all of us, is of a few days and full of trouble. Pastor, didn't God promise a day in which he's going to dry every tear? Oh, he did, but we're not there yet. God's promised a place where there's going to be no more trouble, but we're not in that place. Not yet. But until then, notice a few things and I'll close. Until then, we can find comfort in his person. In verse 33, it says, "These things I have spoken unto you," and notice this, "that in me you might have peace. In the world you shall have tribulation, but be of good cheer, I have overcome the world." The phrase "be of good cheer" is it's an interesting phrase. It's a powerful phrase in the Greek language. It's the word tharseo. It only appears 8 times in the New Testament, and all of the 8 times you find the word tharseo in the New Testament, every single time it's connected to the words of Jesus Christ. For example, in Matthew chapter 9, verse number 2, they brought Jesus to a paralytic lying on a bed, and Jesus saw their faith, and Jesus, you remember what he said to that paralytic? He said, "Take courage, be of good cheer. Tharseo, son, your sins are forgiven." In Matthew chapter number 9 and in Luke chapter number 8, there was the woman who had the issue of blood. Jesus is passing through there's a large crowd around him as he's passing through town, and this woman with the issue of blood, if you recall, she reaches out and touches his robe, the hem of his garment, and the Bible says Jesus felt the power leave his body. He turned around and he said, "Who touched me?" And of course it was that woman. And you remember what he said? He said, "Be of good cheer, take courage, tharseo, your faith has saved you." In Matthew chapter 14 and Mark chapter 6, he comes walking on the water. Disciples are scared, and he looks at his disciples and he says, "It's I, tharseo." In Mark chapter 10, it's the only time the Bible records anyone other than Jesus using this phrase. It's the story of blind Bartimaeus, and he's calling out for mercy. "Have mercy on me, O son of David." You remember what he said, and Jesus called for him to be brought to him. And it was the people around blind Bartimaeus who looked at blind Bartimaeus and said, "Tharseo, Jesus is calling for you." To me, the most interesting usage of the word is in Acts chapter 23, verse number 11. In Acts chapter 23, the Apostle Paul is on trial before the Sanhedrin, and it is a fascinating story. We went through the book of Acts a couple years ago, and so some of you will remember this, but it is a fascinating story that ends up with Paul being confined while 40 men are conspiring to kill him in an ambush. But during the night, Christ appears to Paul, I'm assuming in a vision or a dream, and said, "Tharseo, Paul, be of good cheer, take courage, Paul. Just like you preached in Jerusalem, you're going to preach in Rome." In other words, Paul, don't worry about your life tonight. You're not going to die. You are going to make it to Rome. Tharseo. Remember what took place? The Sanhedrin, they're whispering their plot to the chief priests and the elders, and they're telling them what they're going to do. "We're going to ambush him. We're going to kill him." Matter of fact, one even said, "We're not going to eat anything until he's dead." But they didn't check their surroundings very well, because there was a little boy standing close by who heard every word of it. And of all of the millions of people in Jerusalem at that time, do you know who that little boy just happened to be? Paul's nephew. We didn't even know Paul had a sister if it wasn't for that little verse in Acts chapter number 23. When word gets to Paul, his nephew somehow gets word to him, Paul sends his nephew to talk to the chief of the guards, the Roman guards, whose responsibility is to make sure Paul doesn't escape. Nephew tells the story to the captain of the guard. The captain said, "It ain't happening on my watch." The guard calls for a Roman escort. 200 soldiers, 200 infantrymen with spears, 70 men on horseback, 470 men total. And he called for a horse for Paul. And he says, "Send him to Caesarea. They're not going to get him here." Get the picture. You got 40 little wiry Jewish wannabe preachers, and they've declared that they're going to kill Paul in the morning. Meanwhile, during the third watch of the night, Paul gets escorted out of town in a first century limousine, surrounded by nearly 500 of Rome's finest soldiers. As Paul rides away, someone probably said, "Boy, Paul, you were spared by that Roman captain," and Paul would have known better. He was a tool in the hand of a holy God, because there was a little word ringing in his ear, spoken with a Galilean accent from a resurrected Messiah, Tharseo. Tharseo. "Take courage, Paul. You ain't dying tonight. You're going to Rome to preach." I wonder if Paul had that episode in mind when he writes to the church at Rome, "If God be for us, who can be against us?" Find comfort in his person. But then we find courage in his power. Notice this in verse 33, and I'll close. You got to always remember that a promise, doesn't matter who gives it, the promise is no better than the power of the person who made the promise. And this book is written to help us rightly identify Jesus. That's what John said in John 20, 31. He said, "I wrote this book for that reason." Now, if I were to tell you this morning, if I were to say, look, people are going to try to kill you, but Tharseo, be of good cheer, I'm going to take care of you, you might have a little bit of reason to still be worried. But who made this promise? The one who made this promise to them is the one who faced all of the powers of hell head on a skull-shaped mountain called Calvary. In your mind for a moment, watch him bear your sin in his body on the cross. Listen as he cries in agony and pain and despair. Look as he breathes his last and they take his lifeless body off the cross and place him in a borrowed tomb. But don't leave too soon. Action's going to pick up real soon. Hang out a few days until Sunday, when up from the grave he arose with a mighty triumph o'er his foes. See him standing in resurrected glory, and keep in mind, he's the one who told me, "Be of good cheer, have courage." I'll tell you, you can find courage in his power in the painful seasons of life. You remember Ruth Jones, the pastor's wife, who wrote that hymn "In Times Like These"? Remember how she was troubled by the events of the day as she read 2 Timothy 3:1, where the Bible says, "In the last days, perilous times are coming." Of course, that's why she wrote, "In times like these, you need a savior, you need an anchor. Be very sure your anchor holds and grips the solid rock." I think also that it's pretty obvious that Mrs. Jones was also familiar with Hebrews 6:19. Writer of Hebrews speaks of the finished work of Jesus and says, "Which hope we have as an anchor of the soul, both sure and steadfast." You know how Mrs. Jones concluded her hymn? With another verse, another refrain that goes like this: "In times like these, I have a Savior. In times like these, I have an anchor. I'm very sure, my anchor holds and grips the solid rock. This rock is Jesus. Yes, he's the one. This rock is Jesus. He's the only one. I'm very sure, my anchor holds and grips the solid rock." With our heads bowed and our eyes closed today, what about you? What about you? I don't know what you're facing today. Life may be splendid. There's going to be a time when you're going to you're going to need this anchor. Or you're going to need the Lord Jesus Christ, because you're going to look around, you're going to have nowhere to turn. Do you know Him as Lord and Savior? Do you? Do you know Him as a friend that sticks closer than a brother? Where when times get hard, you can turn to Him. When family forsakes you, friends forsake you. Perhaps your spouse, you're thinking, where do I go from here? You can go to Him. Have you done that? Have you trusted Him as Lord and Savior? If not, why don't you give your heart to Him today? Let Him save your soul. Father, I bow in your presence. I thank you for the Word of God, for this wonderful passage of Scripture that reminds us that Jesus is our anchor. And that during times of tribulation and trouble, that we can be full of cheer because of Him. Amen. What number there, Brother Ken?